Excuse me. Have you seen our house?
Welcome back to the What the Falk Sunderland review show in association with Viper Goalkeeping. Sunderland took a massive win over high-flying Wycombe Wanderers as the Ervin Ibrahimovic struck twice yet again. And unlike last week, it was a match with plenty of talking points. And to join us, we have a relatively packed full house, I would say. In the red and white corner, of course, we've got Jack Shields as always. Jack, how are you doing, mate? Are you all right?
Hi, mate. All right. How's it going?
Always good, mate. Can't complain after a win. That's 4-4 in the review shows. I'm quite happy with this, to be honest. I think we should keep it going for the sheer fact that it seems like we should probably keep doing it because we keep winning. But yes, I'm very well, mate. And of course, we've got an opposition fan as well. We've changed it up a bit this week. Normally, we have the preview man coming on to do the review as well, but we've changed it up a little bit this week. So in the Wycombe corner, we've got Jonny King from Wycombe fanzine The Wanderer. Jonny, how are you doing? Are you all right?
Yeah, not too bad considering. Thanks. How are you guys doing?
Well, yeah, I don't want to rub it in, but we're pretty happy. We're not doing too bad, mate, to be completely honest. And we have got Dave is joining us as well. Whether Dave can hear us yet or not, I don't know. We've had a few issues getting him on. But Dave, if you can hear us, how are you doing? Are you all right?
Yeah, good, mate. I think I've finally got you. I think we're finally there.
You've got that perfect timing, actually, because I was just about to introduce you, and it was that kind of pivotal moment, whether I introduced you or not. But I think we're all happy, apart from Jonny, to be fair, though. But fair play, you've came on. Jonny, I've said this every week because I don't think I could do it, so fair play. But as we said, Sunderland won 3-1. Massive win. I think it was our toughest test of the season. I think Wycombe have started really, really well. I know we've played Wigan first game of the season, but I think if I'm honest, I thought today was going to be the toughest test. We've struggled against Wycombe in the past, and we've come through with flying colours. Obviously, Ross Stewart scored 2 goals. Elliot Embleton scored an absolute screamer and a late goal at the end, which came off someone in wrong-footed Patterson. But by that point, I wasn't too bothered. Ultimately, 3 points for Sunderland. But I'll come to you first, Jack. I came to you first in the intro. In general, mate, we're talking a couple of hours after full-time. How are you feeling?
Yeah, very happy. I thought in terms of how to start the game, Wigan started better. They were the team pressing in on the front foot, and for the first 10 minutes, we were struggling to get out of our own half. They didn't really create any clear-cut chances in that time, but they had all the intensity, they had all of the ball, and really, like you say, you know, the crowd really quietened down, and it looked like we were going to be the one to break the deadlock. And then our first real chance, which is always helpful, we put in the net, and then we got a glorious second. You know, Ross Stewart heads in the first, and then good work between Gooch and Embleton, and Embleton curls in a beautiful second, and I think Wycombe would have knocked stuff on out of Wycombe because they'd actually started quite well, played some good football, but then suddenly find themselves 2-0 down. And I think it took them a bit of time to really get to grips with it after that. And after that, we went from strength to strength. I thought we were the confident team on the front foot, and we never really looked like conceding after that. You know, helpful that Ross Stewart killed it with a third. Disappointed not to get the clean sheet because I thought a clean sheet would have been great, but maybe 3-0 would have flattered us. I think 3-0 would have been harsh on Wycombe. I don't think we were that much better than them today. I just think it's good now that we've got so many options going forward, and we look like we've got real strength and depth in the team, and we've got options available. You know, we brought off Aidan O'Brien off the bench, who scored a hat-trick on Tuesday night. We've got players like Alex Pritchard, who brought off the bench, who I thought looked really good. And yeah, really positive. I'm enjoying going to Sunderland games again. I hope it continues.
Nice, isn't it? But talking about Alex Pritchard, I keep calling him Harry. I don't know why. I don't know where Harry Pritchard's come from, but someone please drum it into my head that it's Alex. Dave, I'll stick with the red and white corner, mate, but how's things been from your side? How do you feel in the aftermath of the game 2 hours later?
Yeah, just really, really promising, isn't it? Kind of, we look a force going forward, which is nice. Something we haven't really, we've always looked like scoring one, maybe two a game. And at the minute, I'd actually thought very unjust and not much reason for it. But I just had a really good feeling this morning. And I thought that we'd win 5-0. So I said we'd be 2-0 up by half-time.
That is not just a good feeling. That's a how much have you been drinking and what have you been taking, feeling, especially if you've supported Sunderland for as long as we have, which I think you have.
That's it, mate. Yeah, I just don't know. I've just genuinely got a really good feeling at the minute. I guess it comes from like the Burton game. For as much as we got beat, I thought we actually played well at the same time. So you kind of, it's nice to not be getting too downbeat by getting beat, you know. But yeah, I thought Jack summed it up really well, to be honest. Kind of, yeah, Wycombe definitely had the first 12, 15 minutes. Looked very typical Gareth Ainsworth side, you know, kind of tenacious, like snapping at your heels, like playing the referee. Let's be honest, another absolutely woeful refereeing performance from someone in this league. It's just
horrendous. Horrendous today, actually, yeah.
I don't think is it Hogan, the Wycombe player? I don't think he's going to get away with punching someone, unfortunately. I'd imagine they'll look back on that.
I need to look at that because we think it was Memedy.
Right, okay.
But then other people have said Hogan as well, so I'm not sure, but I don't know how we're getting it mixed up because one of them is very ginger, one of them's not. So somebody needs their eyes testing in the Sunderland fan base. I don't know who. Whichever one it was, please don't punch our players. It will be appreciated. Please leave that at Portsmouth fans. It's much more appreciated.
I was going to say, he had some stick logo 9, doesn't he? Punch off Wycombe players, kick off Portsmouth fans. I mean, I'm not his biggest fan, but like, he doesn't deserve that.
It's a bit harsh. But Johnny, I always feel bad doing this for the opposition fans when we've won, but it's nice. But obviously, there's always another team. Do you know what I mean? There's always another side. There's always another viewpoint. How do you feel in the aftermath of the game?
Obviously disappointed, but not too down. I mean, there's no shame in losing 3-1 to Sunderland. And I think based on how you play today, how you start the season, there's going to be teams, you know, bigger teams than Wycombe are going to go to the Stadium of Light and come off a lot worse than that. So we played all right in stages. Maybe at times you could argue we were maybe the better side. So I'm not that down. You know, it's 5 games in. It's not a disaster. It's disappointing, but you know, yeah, there's absolutely no shame in losing to Sunderland. And same as when we last went to the Stadium of Light, put in a much worse performance and you hammered us that day. Could have been double figures. And I came away from that game thinking, I was disappointed, but it's like, well, we've just gone to Sunderland and lost 4-0. Like 7 years ago, we nearly went out of the Football League. So it's all relative and it's kind of still quite fun losing to Sunderland. So yeah, it's all right. I mean, we're still living the dream a bit, really. Let's face it, we by rights, you know, we should be playing Barrow probably. So it's a shame, but I'm pleased with how things are going, generally speaking. So, yeah, no complaints.
I think in context as well, I think everyone's now lost one game. I could be wrong with that. I haven't officially checked, but obviously we lost to Burton. And I think when we lost against Burton, we played well and you kind of got on with it. I really don't think Wycombe were terrible. I'd love to say they were, but I really don't think you were. I thought first 15 minutes, I agree with Jack, you were probably the better team. And obviously with 2 bits of quality and that changes the game and turns it on its head. But I think Wycombe are going to be in and around there. And I think as much as I don't like doing the whole plucky smaller team because I find it quite patronising sometimes. But like, to be honest with you, I think Wycombe will be in and around there, which is punching well above the weight that, you know, historically you have been. So I completely understand that viewpoint 100%. I'll come back to you, Jack, regarding team selection. Obviously, it was much the same for us. We had Alex Pritchard came out. I almost said Harry again, for God's sake. Pritchard came out and the Sirkin, whatever you want to call him, got himself out of a little pickle, see what I did there, and came back into the team. At the time when you seen the team, relatively happy with what Lee Johnson went with?
Yeah, I'm always thinking, you know, if you're winning games, it's hard to change. And I think Aidan O'Brien might have counted himself a little bit unlucky. He scores a hat-trick in midweek, doesn't he, at Blackpool and took all of his goals out. So he can maybe think, well, why didn't I get him? But really, I can't really fault, you know, the way that, you know, I can't really fault any of Lee Johnson's selections. And I felt that the personnel that we have now, really, it's great that we have options. Do you know what I mean? We've got players that can say, we'll play this formation, we'll play that. We're simply having strength and depth, do you know what I mean? I mean, we had 5 or 6 players there that were on the bench that but have easily played and play regularly, going to play regularly this season for us. And I think, really, I think what we've changed this season compared to the previous seasons, we now seem to have more ability in the team. We seem to have a bit of athleticism and pace, and players that can really, you know, carry the ball and create chances. And I think we are going to create a lot of chances this season. And when you've got someone like Ross Stewart, who's in form and can hold the ball up and bring others into play, you know what I mean, you're going to get a lot of opportunities in the final third. And I think really, you know, like I say, the fact you have so many options means that over the course of the season, touched on it last week as well, but it is a long season. We're going to have 46 League One games, lots of cup games, and you're going to have to utilise that squad. And often it's the squad, you know, it's the team with the best, the club with the best squad that goes on and gets promotion. And I think we're up there now with real strength and depth, so I'm happy with everything.
Dave, I'll come to you next regarding the team selection. There's been a bit of an argument about McGeady's form. There's been a bit of umbrage shown towards the way Lyndon Gooch has done that frustrating thing where he does really, really, really well and then doesn't release it correctly. They both played really well today. Do you think they justified the selection?
Yeah, I mean, I think a lot of it's probably like a big, major psychological thing with McGeady. If a team knows that McGeady's in the opposition, surely their whole pre-match is about doubling up on him and stuff like that, which then, of course, releases other players, which is probably what happened with Gooch in the first game where he had such a stormer. They're so worried about the left-hand side of the pitch that Gooch has got a little bit more time to kind of get on the ball and do his thing. But yeah, both played really well. And a big shout-out to Lugo 9 today as well, because I am not the greatest Lugo 9 fan at all. I think he's a lovely lad. I think we've heard all the banter from everyone.
There's always that's always the next line, isn't it? He's a lovely lad. But he's a lovely lad. He's a very nice lad.
I think my nana wants him to come round for tea, you know what I mean?
I love him. I love him as a player, I love him as a person. I would definitely take him home to my mum. 100%.
Definitely. But what I noticed today was watching him specifically. He had his high octane pressure, winning the ball back, very tenacious, very good. But there was a couple of times which he probably could have been told, in his head, could have tried the 25-yard, 35-yard Hollywood ball, and he stopped himself and he gave it 5 yards to Dan Neil, to Elliot Embleton. And I thought that everyone's always said since we signed Luke 09, the big thing with him is he wants to improve as a footballer all the time. He's very self-critical of himself. And I've no doubt that Johnson and the backroom staff had a word with him kind of after last week, and he did it really well today. I was very well impressed with that, to be honest.
Yeah, I was impressed with Lugo 9 today. And I know it's seemingly an unpopular opinion to like Lugo 9 these days, but I love him. There's my flag in the sand or whatever it is. Jonny, one player I was kind of a little bit worried about today was Gareth McCleary, and obviously he wasn't in the squad today. I don't know if that was some sort of injury or something like that, but aside from that, your lineup kind of chose itself. But what was wrong with McCleary today? What happened there?
He travelled with the squad, but woke up apparently this morning with a bug, so had to miss out. That's a real blow for us, because obviously he started the season really well.
Yeah,
he's looking like he's forming quite a good partnership with Vokes. So yeah, we missed him today. We missed him, and we missed also Anthony Stewart at the back, who got a knock in training. We really missed his presence at the back. So yeah, two big misses, really.
I mean, we'll go into the game itself. The first 15 minutes, Jonny, I think we've all said, I honestly thought up until we scored the first goal that Wycombe, I wouldn't say looked the more likely, but you looked the better side. You're keeping the ball better. You're chasing Harry and having that kind of typical Ainsworth performance that we've kind of become accustomed to. But there was sort of a lack of cutting edge. I kind of felt up until you put the ball in the back of the net at the point when it didn't really matter. Something wasn't quite right with it. How much of that comes down to Gareth McCleary not playing?
It doesn't help. But, you know, but that's when you want the other players to step up. I mean, Organ's a good player, and, you know, international for Republic of Ireland. He's just been called up to the squad again. But we signed him last summer, and so far he's scored one goal for us. So we do need to see, not so much folks because he's been doing his bit, but we need to see our forward players stepping up a bit more. They're not quite clicking yet. There's an over-reliance on Vokes and McCleary. So, yeah, McCleary's a big miss, but you can't rely on one player. So yeah, bit disappointed with our four players today. Like you said, we weren't bad, but just lacked a cutting edge for all the good play. And that's what I'm disappointed about today. The result. I'm not disappointed about the result. I'm disappointed about kind of the manner in which we didn't apply ourselves up front.
I would agree with that, to be fair. I felt like there was a lot of the ball, but in the first 15 minutes, I for some reason never felt like a goal was incoming. And obviously, you score two goals in however many minutes it was, and it's a different game entirely. Jack, I just want to come back to you a little bit with that. Obviously, first 10, 15 minutes, like we said, I thought we struggled a bit. Where do you think that first 15 minutes, just to kind of have a little bit of a negative, if there is one, where do you think that went wrong, the first 10, 15? What do you think we didn't do right?
I don't think it's a case of us doing something wrong. I think you've got to give a bit of credit to Wycombe. I think you see a lot of teams come to the stadium, and I agree, and not park the bus, but they're very aware of the crowd and the fact that we can do to other teams what Wycombe did to us. And I think Wycombe were right. They must have been fired up from Ainsworth before the match, and he's obviously said, look, get right at them, you know, in the faces, don't let them get out. And I was really impressed with, even when we were 1-2-3-0 up, I was impressed with Wycombe's pressing. I thought they pressed us quite a lot, really. They were really right down in our faces and really pressed us when we were on the ball. And I thought that was good. We started to do it to them a little bit, ironically, in the second half, and we got a little bit of joy from that. But I thought you've got to give credit to Wycombe. I don't think it was a case of us doing anything majorly wrong. I just think Wycombe came all out and all guns blazing. And like I say, we got the two goals, probably against the run of play. And I think it really knocked the stuffing out of Wycombe, because they had as good as a start as they could have had without scoring, really. You know what I mean? From the first 15 minutes, Ainsworth would have said, you've done exactly what I wanted, apart from put the ball in the back of the net. And goals do change games. The fact we got one, not just 1-2, they were like, wow, how have we played so well after 15 minutes and 15, 20 minutes, and we found ourselves 2-0 down. And then after that, we've got a control in the game. We start to keep the ball better. And really, I didn't really feel they were threatening us after that, but yeah, I think give credit to Wycombe. I don't think we did anything wrong. I think it was them making a better start than we all expected.
The one thing I can't give credit to Wycombe for, though, Jack, and I'm sorry in advance, Johnny, two buttons down on Gareth Ainsworth's shirt, chest fully out, skinny jeans and what looked like crocodile boots. Gareth, I'm pretty confident you're not listening, but no. And trust me, I've wore some funny looking things, but the chest thing, I'm just not having it. I'm sorry, just not having it. Dave, I wanted to speak to you about, obviously, the goals. For me, the big difference in the first 15, 20 minutes is Wycombe had more of the ball. Wycombe looked more likely, if you prefer. And then we popped it with two bits of quality. We've seen that happen to us before, maybe in the Premier League, where we've been the better side for 15, 20 minutes and then two bits of magic happen. Is it a real positive that we've seen today that we could put a game almost beyond the team just because we had simply more quality to just turn up on the day and just turn up and put in a 25-yarder and then that fantastic cross and a big striker like Ross Stewart banging it in? Are we starting to see genuine quality for the first time that Sunderland have been in League One here?
I think it's a word that Jack used again. Has a lot of what Jack's saying. I'm sitting here nodding my head. Mobility. Like having mobility to get up from one end of the pitch to the other end in seconds is something that we haven't either tried to do or had the players to do. So to have it, it's amazing. I've said before with you, it's kind of, I feel really guilty the fact that I don't like Charlie Wycombe, and I'm just going to keep mentioning him every week until he doesn't score, because I just love it. But I feel guilty that I don't like the 31 goal striker, and I don't. Like Ross Stewart could not score a game for the rest of the season, and I just love him. In fact, anyone asks me what me come down with me dinner is, Ross Stewart Ross and Luke Stewart. O'Neill, they're there, them, they're there with me. Do you know what I mean? But in all seriousness, yeah, I mean, I saw a tweet go out earlier. Embleton, best thing that it could have happened to him was that loan deal to Blackpool. He's come back. He seems hungry.
Yeah,
it's his local club. We've got players who actually who seem to have to want to have a little bit of a chip on their shoulder and progress. And honestly, for the dynamic of the squad, you just can't underestimate how much that's going to push us forward. You know, there's there's no way someone like Niall Huggins, for example, is going to want to sit on the bench in a League One football club. He's just not going to want to do it. So all that means is the intensity in training day upon day, week upon week, is going to improve. And I think that stands us in good stead. And then looking at Johnson's comments through the week, I get the feeling there could be one or two big name signings this week, you know.
I think Mbappe is on the way, I've got to be honest. I think Mbappe might be I just think you'd fancy a challenge Mbappe, and I think Sunderland is the challenge of challenges, you know what I mean? And I might have played a lot of Football Manager, but my point is my point, you know what I mean? I think Mbappe may be on the way.
The thing is, I'm not sure he gets in ahead of like any of the front four at the minute.
He's a good backup for Ross Stewart, though, to be fair.
Kane hasn't gone to Man City yet, has he? He's still available.
Not yet. You never know. You never know. Maybe that's what Harry Kane was waiting on. But not getting in ahead of Ross Stewart. We'll probably end up back in Fenway at this rate, to be fair.
He loves our crowd, man. He loves the banter with the Sunderland fans, doesn't he?
Big fan of Akinfenwa. Big fan. One thing, obviously, before going to the game, but Dave, Elliot Embleton's goal. Like, I'm going to hold my hands up here and say, oh, I would have probably played Pritchard today. I'm not 100% sold on Embleton. I'm wrong. I was completely wrong on Elliot Embleton. He's very, very good, but that goal was exquisite, wasn't it, Dave?
Oh, brilliant, mate. It's just... And I'll tell you what, yeah, absolutely unbelievable. The fact that he's both-footed and so comfortable on both feet is a nightmare for defenders and an absolute asset to us. And I tell you what, it's just, I watched the game from Belgium today. I was in Croatia last week watching it. I was in Belgium today watching it.
All right, Alan Wicker. All right, Alan Wicker. Fair enough.
Well, that's what you got to do, isn't it? You're not allowed to watch it in England at 3 o'clock on a Saturday. So I've got a country hop, you know. So yeah, literally the reaction that he's getting from the crowd, from what I heard with the stream, because the commentary went off, the crowd were buzzing, man. The crowd were absolutely electric today. And I tell you what, big statement. We get through 12 to 15 games continuing the form that we're on, we'll be back up to 33,000-35,000, I reckon.
Yeah, that's, I think so too.
I'm going out there with that. So, yeah, honestly, what a strike, what a finish. It's amazing when you see all these silly little clips with the keepers making, like, token dives when the ball's going out for a throw-in and stuff with a shot. But the Wycombe keeper today, he definitely tried for that and he was getting nowhere near it.
I can't believe, I forgot, I thought it was Allsop that was in goal, but it was actually Stockdale, of course. And
Stockdale, yeah.
He's not aging well, is he? He's not aging well. I was a bit like, oh, bloody hell, I thought you were still 24. We'll have to kind of discuss it. In the cold light of day, it doesn't matter. It didn't affect the game, but I don't think any of us necessarily like to see that what was quite evidently a punch on Luke O'Nine from a Wycombe player. We haven't decided if it was Hogan or Memedy yet, but I'll come to you first, Johnny, because it's quite easy to go up with Sunderland fan and say, like, well, that's disgusting and terrible. What did you make of it? But what were your thoughts from a Wycombe side? Because it's a lack of discipline, isn't it, really? What was the Wycombe reaction to that sort of punch?
Yeah, I mean, I've only seen kind of a bit of the pixelated replay, and it looked like Mometi, and which, I mean, literally, if I hadn't seen it and you'd said a Wycombe player threw a punch and I had to pick who it was from my entire squad, he'd be the last player I'd pick, including someone who's currently on loan at King's Lynn. Like, that's how unlikely. but yeah, I think, I mean, it's interesting, I did a preview for the game for A Love Supreme, and they said, who are you most worried about? And obviously you've got this wealth of attacking talent, but I said Luke O'Nine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love him. He's still loved at Wycombe. I love that boy, but he's a bastard to play against. And you know, he was, and you love it when he's doing it for you, but if he's doing it against you, you hate it. And he knows how to get under players' skinned, and you know, the other players just got to know not to rise to it. And Mometi, he's 20 years old. He's only recently turned 20, I think. He was playing. I mean, he's a great player. He was playing non-league football.
Ninth tier or something, wasn't it?
Sorry, say again.
Was it the ninth tier or something he was playing or something like that, wasn't it? He was quite far down.
the Essex League or something. Yeah. Right. And we picked him up for our development squad and he kind of forced his way into the team and he's now an Albanian under 21 international, make of that what you will. But he is a, you know, our best creative player, but he's raw as hell. He's got a lot to learn. And I think he's learned, well, I think he will learn, because I don't think he's going to get away with it, learn a big mm-hmm. lesson about discipline and, you know, the harsh realities of playing, you know, professional football. And he's let himself down. And obviously I'm a biased Wycombe fan, but you don't like to see it at all. And, you know, and he's probably going to get, what, a 5-game ban now? And we've lost our best attacking player, probably. So, yeah, no, it's bad news, but hopefully he'll learn from it. And sometimes players have to go through this early in their careers to kind of learn the harsh lessons so they don't do it again.
I find it quite interesting you mentioned about Luke 09, because I've noticed that, and I noticed it a few years ago, that he is basically a bastard to play against, because I remember him like sort of playing and getting rolled on the pitch against Doncaster sort of before the pandemic and stuff. But there's a big thing about Sunderland that, because he does his community work, because he speaks to the fans, because he's open and he's a very nice bloke. He obviously is a lovely bloke. But I've always said that on the pitch, he's actually a bit nasty. And I'm pleased you've said that. I think, did you see that side of him today, that you were used to at Wycombe? Because I've seen it today, that he knew how to wind your players up. He knew what he was doing. It seemed like he'd learned the dark arts at Wycombe and he used them back on you. That's how it felt today, Jonny. Would I be right in saying that?
Yeah, I think so. And yeah, I mean, obviously it's personal taste, whether or not you find that kind of tasteful. And you know, sometimes I see Wycombe players do it. So, you know, saw Luke do it for Wycombe. There were times where it was a bit cringy, but I think you need it at this level. You need that blend of quality, which Sunderland have definitely got. And if I've got, from the outside looking in the past when I've seen Sunderland play Wycombe, I've kind of thought that's what they're missing. They're missing that kind of bit of an edge to them. And I don't know your team well enough to know if you've got other players like that, but this Sunderland team looked the real deal. And I think it's blending that quality with that edge. And, you know, if you have to turn it on, you can turn on and you know, and kind of not physically square, but, you know, square up to teams that try and kind of physically dominate you, which maybe wasn't maybe the case in the last sort of 2-3 seasons.
I 100% agree with you on that, Jonny. I think we've said for ages we don't seem to have. I think the team realised they're in League One. I think the fans realised they're in League One. I've had a few too many pints. But I think at the same time, a lot of the team maybe didn't have that edge. And there was certain teams, especially in the first and the second season, would come up, put 10 men behind the ball and play at and waste time. And Wycombe were hugely one of those teams, and it got under our skin and got under our nose. It felt today that we managed to do it back a little bit, because if the referee or the assistant or one of the linesmen or the other lineswoman had their glasses on, you would have been down to 10 men, because we basically played that dark arts card, and that sometimes needs to happen. And it's not illegal, it's just gamesmanship. And I think you do need that at this level. I really think you do. But Jack, I want to talk about a big, huge positive today, a massive positive for the whole season. I honestly think we need to get him tied down to a contract. Dan Neil, I don't like to swear on this pod too much, but was absolutely fucking unbelievable again. And he's one of ours and I love him. And I reckon he'll probably get in the England squad for the next World Cup. But how much of an important player has he become just overnight?
Does he get better every time I watch him? He's like, he's, you know, a player that's been playing 10, 15 years at this top level. And I'm saying, I think his ability on the ball now is matched, because we've got players that can move off the ball with a bit of athleticism and pace, and really linking up together. I think his vision and his passing is unbelievable. And I think we're going to watch him develop this season, and he can only get better. If he's this good at this age, with not many first-team games behind him, imagine how good he's going to be with a full season behind him.
So you left us there, Jack, and obviously Dave at the same time has also gone at the same time. So that perfect timing that all the Sunderland fans have left. You must have had enough of me. But I think when it comes to another really good performance today, and I want to get both viewpoints on this, and then we'll obviously just wrap up. But I was concerned a little bit that Callum Doyle might have his toughest test today, because he's coming up against Sam Vokes, Callum Doyle's 17 years old. We can all see he's got the raw ability and the raw talent. But Sam Vokes, when we're talking about being rehearsed in the dark arts, he's played for Stoke, Burnley and Wycombe. You pretty much couldn't get three clubs that know the dark arts better. And he's played for Wales in like a good European championship when he got the semi-final. He obviously is well-rehearsed and just experienced gamesmanship. I thought he was absolutely honking today. And I think a lot of that came down to the fact that Callum Doyle just almost took the piss out of him. I'm criticising Sam Vokes here, but just how good was Callum Doyle again, Jack?
Yeah, really, really good. Again, similar to what I said with Dan Neil. If he's this good at this age, he's a future England international. I really do think that. His confidence and composure, you know what I mean? You can all have a big physique and be a big snarl and tough defender, but it's his confidence with the ball, it's his composure that he shows. And I think Sam Vokes is a decent striker at this level. I think Wickham have got themselves a decent player there. And I was really worried when I saw him. I thought he could give our defence a little bit of chip today. And I have to say, I thought he was poor. He took him up, the games took him off after 65, 70 minutes and brought back and Fenner on. And I was really disappointed. I'm happily disappointed because I thought he could have given us problems. But like you say, maybe you have to give credit to our defence because he didn't get a kick.
And we're talking about credit for players. I'm going to say I've never been his biggest fan. Tom Flanagan has been excellent. He's talking a young defence through games and also playing really, really, really well himself. I think other people have said the same thing, but I really want to talk about Tom Flanagan. But before I move sort of on to the end of the podcast, Donny, I'll come to you as well. We talked a bit earlier about Akinfenwa when I said I thought he was your best player. I thought Sam Vokes was really poor today. I really thought he was poor. But is that a poor performance from Sam Vokes from your side, or do you think our young centre-back and Callum Doyle just literally mocked him out of the game?
It's a bit non-committal, but I'd probably say a bit of both. I mean, based on what I've seen of Vokes so far this season, he's looked good, but probably looking a little bit rusty, not more or less match fit, but not quite 100%. And probably, I think he was out of the picture at Stoke for quite a while. So,
yeah,
I think he's not quite 100% sort of match sharp, so to speak. But I think he will get there. I mean, he was great against Cheltenham, but that's the thing. And, you know, in this League One, it's a bit of a weird league and you've got, you know, Cheltenham and Sunderland and Portsmouth all in the same division. And then there's a big difference between the quality of players. And as you've already said, he's just absolutely kind of really well marshalled today. And yeah, so probably a bit of both. I know it's not a very helpful answer, but.
No, if it's honest opinion, always helpful, I think. I think one thing we're all in agreement on is that Callum Doyle will probably be the next Bobby Moore. We've just got to be honest about it. He's been that good. This is why I don't do the reaction shows too much, because I get too excited, you see. But ultimately, you know, looking at the statistics, both sides were quite equal. The big difference there, I think, ultimately was we just showed more quality when we needed to, and I think that's massive. End of the game, we were all singing it. It's the first time Sunderland have actually been clear at the top of League One. It's actually the first time we've ever been top if you take out the first ever game we had in League One when we were the early kickoff and beat Charlton 2-1. So technically, not the first time we've been clear, it's the first time we've really been top of the league in League One. It's really early days, Jack, but does this feel more like a Sunderland side who can actually progress and actually get out of League One eventually?
Yeah, I think we're on the right track now. I think we've got the squad right. Not just in terms of personnel, but in terms of overall depth to it. And I'm a lot more confident with Lee Johnson. I think he plays a good attack and progressive style of play that's going to get us out of this division, hopefully. I think we're getting things right off the field as well, right recruitment process and the right ownership. And I think we're on the right track now. I think we're closer now than we've ever been.
Feels nice, doesn't it? Feels nice to say that. We'll come back to this in 6 weeks and see if we were right or wrong. Johnny, it's a bit of a difficult question for me to ask because I'm asking you about a team that, you know, you don't watch every week because I'm asking you about Sunderland. I'm very confident that Wickham will be up and around there this season. I think you will be in the discussion and will be our promotion rivals. But you've been promoted. You've came up against us in the past. You've got the better of us. You've sometimes been tonked by us. You've sometimes managed to get a draw from us. You've been around long enough to see Sunderland in League One. Based on today's game solely, does Sunderland suddenly look like a team that actually might get out of this division based on your experience of previous Sunderland sides?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not just saying it. I genuinely think so. Like, you know, like I said, I think you've always had quality players in your squad. You've got that that edge now. I think maybe you've got a bit more managerial stability because, I mean, obviously I'm kind of, I don't follow Sunderland, but it's, at one point he's going to be changing manager every 40 minutes, but you've had Johnson in now and he's maybe not like a glamorous manager in terms of, you know, he's not done loads of stuff at other clubs, but he looks to be just a perfect fit for Sunderland. And yeah, I mean, you know, today looked hungry, clinical. I mean, it's all fine margins, isn't it? And and today when you had the chance, you were absolutely ruthless. And that's what I mean when I said, you know, I think this Sunderland team looks a real deal. You've got off to a cracking start in a league which is notoriously kind of where teams kind of self-sabotage a bit and trip themselves up. So, and the season we went up, we got off to a good start and just kept that going for so long that even when we kind of started to kind of wobble a bit, we built up so much kind of credit in the bank that we never dropped out of the promotion places. So if you can keep this good run going, you know, you could well get yourself clear within sort of, you know, when the table starts to open out after about another 10 games, probably you could be, you know, running away with it. So yeah, this Sunderland team do look a class apart from previous seasons, I have to say.
Fingers crossed. That's how it feels, but I don't know. I'm touching wood. I'm crossing my fingers and I'm doing everything that people normally do. 10 games time, I agree, though. I think we'll start to see where the Sunderland team's really going to be at, and hopefully it's where it all seems to be going. But I'll let everyone get on with their Saturday night. Dave has left us. His internet has packed in. His internet has gone and Dave has left. But Dave, as always, has been great. Jack, thank you very much for popping on. And Johnny, thanks always for coming on after a defeat. I like saying that. I've said it every week since I started this review, but I do genuinely mean it because I don't know if I could do it. But obviously, do subscribe, do check in, do listen, share it if you want. If you don't, it's fine. If Sunderland win, I've got to be honest, I don't really care what you do with it. 3 points is the most important thing. But enjoy your Saturday night or your Sunday morning. And how are the lads, as always? Our house.